Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we praise and worship you for your goodness, love, and mercy. As creator of the world, you gave us life and breath. As preserver of all life, you provide for us day by day. As redeemer of all mankind, you show us your love in Christ. We praise you that the Lord is King, and his Spirit has been poured into our hearts. In Christ, we join the heavenly host to praise, to worship, and to adore. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, praise be to your name, O Lord Most High. Amen. Matthew chapter 2, beginning at the first verse. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose, and we've come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all of Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. Out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go search carefully for the child. As soon as you find it, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they'd seen when it rose went ahead of them till it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with the gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. This is the word of the Lord. We're in the Christian season of Epiphany. In some churches, Epiphany is just celebrated on one day. In others, it's not really thought about at all. And in still others, the whole period between Christmas and Lent is taken up with Epiphany. Now, Epiphany means to show or to reveal or to understand. If you have an Epiphany, it means you've suddenly realized something. The Epiphany we're celebrating today remembers the visit of the wise men to Jesus and what that reveals or shows us about him, what we can understand from their visit. That's the focus of our service today. What can we understand about Jesus from the visit of the wise men, and what does it mean for us? Now, before we get onto what this passage might mean for us and why Jesus is the greatest present of all time, there are several things in this passage which challenge the traditional image that we have in our heads about the visit of the wise men. Matthew is the only book in the Bible that tells us about this visit, so we need to listen to what's actually said. The first myth is that there were three wise men. Matthew doesn't tell us how many men there were. It uses the term men, so there were more than one, but there could have been two, there might have been three, or four, or any number. Traditional pictures have three because, of course, three gifts were brought. The second myth is that the wise men were kings. Matthew does not use the word king. Instead, the gospel uses the word magi. Now, a magi was a bit of a general word. It could mean a wise ruler or teacher or even an astrologer. These men were certainly important, but they were not likely to have been kings. The third myth is that the wise men arrived on the same night as the shepherds. Now, Matthew tells us these wise men came from the east after they had seen a star, which they interpreted as being the birth of the Messiah. And indeed, the chapter opens after Jesus was born. So Jesus is already born when these men set off on their journey. And they go on quite a long journey. And when they finally arrive in Israel, of course, they go to the wrong place initially. They go to Herod's palace. Herod knows nothing about some sort of rival ruler. And so he orders that all the chief priests be gathered together. Now, that's not likely to have happened in a few minutes. People probably had to make journeys up to Jerusalem to gather. He then sort of convenes some sort of council where they discuss where the Messiah is to be born. And then he holds a secret meeting with the wise men before they go on their way. And then we discover that the star rises again so that they can follow it to Bethlehem. All of that took some time. Later on, of course, when Herod realizes he's been tricked and the wise men have not returned back to him, he orders an issue to kill every male boy under the age of two. So Jesus is a toddler, really, by the time the wise men arrive. And we're told they arrive at a house, apart from anything else, not a stable or inn or anywhere else. Now, it does not really matter how many wise men there were. As I say, there may have been three, we just don't know. What I want us to think about is the fact that these wise men went to extraordinary lengths to find Jesus. They left their home and they journeyed, possibly for over a year, to discover him. And not only did they go to extraordinary lengths to find Jesus, they brought extraordinary gifts as well, gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. And you probably think, well, I thought you said these people were wise. Why? What does a baby want with gold, frankincense and myrrh? We don't know what happened to the gifts. They may have been kept. We know that Joseph and Mary and Jesus had to quickly flee to Egypt. So maybe those gifts were sold in order to have money to live on. The gifts are important, not because they were kept, but because they reveal to us who Jesus is. They help us to recognize who Jesus is. They were costly gifts. Gold fit for a king, reminding us Jesus is our king, our ruler. Sometimes we've said that frankincense is a gift which reminds us that Jesus is God. Incense is something which is burned at a time of prayer, as our prayers pictured rising to God. Of course, we don't need incense to pray, but it is a physical aid which some people use. And then finally, myrrh, possibly the most controversial of the gifts. This was a perfume sometimes associated with healing, sometimes with death, because it would have been a fragrance put on a dead body. It reminds us that this child was born as both king and God, but also born in this world in order to die for us. So Jesus is our king, our God, our priest, our healer, our sacrifice. And that's really Epiphany. That's who Jesus is. And as we discover more of who he is, so we come to worship him. And the wise men were wise because they worshiped Jesus. They made that long journey. And the first thing they do, of course, is bow in worship to Jesus. And we gather, whether that's in church or over the internet, we gather in order to worship. So I just want to pause for a few moments. Maybe you just want to pause if you're watching this on Zoom, just to pause the presentation for a moment, just to consider how you might respond to Jesus today. I find it really interesting that the two groups of people that the Bible tells us visited Jesus were so different from one another. Now, we know that the Magi were pretty special, wise men, travellers from the East, whatever they were. But of course, who were the other people that visited Jesus? They were shepherds, the lowliest of the low. They were the second-class citizens, the social outcasts not accepted by society. And what did they bring to Jesus? As far as we're aware, they brought nothing but themselves. I know we have that line in the hymn, "If I were a shepherd, I'd bring a lamb," but we don't know if they actually gave any gifts to Jesus. As far as we know, they just brought themselves. Nowhere near as spectacular then as the arrival of the Magi, yet the New Testament records their presence in Luke's Gospel with Mary and Joseph, just as the Magi are recorded in Matthew. And as we read through the New Testament, we come across several other instances in which people bring things to Jesus. We read, for example, about a little boy who was willing to give Jesus his pat lunch, and with which Jesus, of course, fed 5,000 people. Then the story of the woman who brings expensive perfume and pours all over Jesus, much to the disgust of some of the disciples who feel she could have spent that money on something else. A couple of weeks ago, we celebrated the birth of Jesus. What is it that we're bringing him today? What gift, talent, resource do you have that you could offer him this morning? It doesn't matter whether it's something seemingly extravagant or simply yourself. In fact, the Bible suggests that giving ourselves is the best gift that we can offer. So let's pray. What can I give him, poor as I am? If I were a shepherd, I would bring a lamb. If I were a wise man, I would do my part, yet what I can I give him, give my heart. Lord, at the dawn of this new year, may we give our lives to you unreservedly, and we ask this in your name. Amen.
Together, wonderful to me.
Believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again? Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Good.
We just take a few moments now to bring before God anything that we particularly want to pray for today. And we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen. Thank you. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.